to start.
Yes. Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee in Session 5. We have received apologies today from Ross Greer, MSP, but we'd like to welcome Alison Johnson, MSP, to the committee. I'd like to remind members and the public to turn off any mobile phones, and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers should please ensure that they are turned to silent. Today we'll hear from the UK Minister of State for Trade and Investment and then from the Secretary of State for Scotland on the implications of the EU referendum result for Scotland. Via video conference, I'd like to welcome the Right Honourable Greg Hands MP, Minister of State for Trade and Investment. Good morning, Minister. I understand you will make a short opening statement before we move to questions from committee members.
Brilliant. Well, thank you, Madam Convener, if I may, and thank you for making this possible. I hope the technology is going to work. First of all, apologies from my... Can I just check everybody can hear me, first of all?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay. So, first of all, apologies from my Secretary of State, Dr. Liam Fox, who's travelling in Asia this week. But like him, I am fully committed to engaging on trade with the Scottish Government at the Scottish Parliament. Indeed, I enjoyed appearing a year ago in my last role in front of both the Scottish Parliament's Finance Committee and the Constitution and Future Powers Committee, which were both in Edinburgh, and I'm hoping to come and see you in person at some point as soon as we can. The Prime Minister, Madam Kavita, earlier this year set out her vision for the UK's future as a truly global Britain. Included in this was her strong view that the UK should be the most passionate and convincing advocate of global free trade anywhere in the world. The UK government and the devolved administrations need to work together to make Brexit a success. A unified voice strengthens our hand in the upcoming negotiations. And that is why the UK government has set up a new joint ministerial committee on EU negotiations to discuss each devolved administration's requirements for the future relationship with the EU and to feed into a UK approach to the negotiations. Our Department for International Trade is dedicated to serving the whole of the United Kingdom, now and when we leave the EU. Our department's responsibility covers support to new and existing UK exporters, outward investment from the UK, and inward investment into every part of the UK. I should point out that Britain's future trading relationship with the European Union is primarily a matter for the Department for exiting the European Union, although we do and will continue to feed into those deliberations. Meanwhile, at the Department for International Trade, we work hand in hand with Scottish Development International, SDI, which is responsible for implementing programmes that meet the particular needs of companies in Scotland, as well as promoting Scotland to foreign investors. Whilst promotion of trade and investment is a concurrent power, trade policy and UK export finances' ability to support exports are, as we know, reserved matters. This means we can and do pool intelligence and work better for the benefit of the UK. For example, our Trade Department provides Scottish companies with access to events and trade mission support schemes. Our world-leading digital services, as part of great.gov.uk, which make it easier for firms to trade overseas, are an available resource for Scottish companies, and I urge them to make use of them. And today, my department's trade policy officials will be hosting a briefing session for officials from each of the devolved administrations on the work of the WTO. By working together, we can ensure that when one part of the UK succeeds, we all do. Our fortunes are inextricably linked. I, Madam Kavina, like much of Scotland, campaigned on the Remain side during the referendum. Indeed, 70% of my constituents voted to remain. But this was a UK-wide referendum. I am, above all, a democratic politician, and more people voted to leave the UK than for anything else in our electoral history. And if you look at the figures, it is clear which union should matter more to the consumers and businesses of Scotland. While Scottish exports to EU countries totaled £12.3 billion sterling in 2015, Scotland sold goods and services to the rest of the UK worth £49.8 billion, four times as much. So this is four times more than exports to the European Union and three times the level exported to the rest of the world. Trade with the UK single market supports 270,000 Scottish jobs, roughly 10% of Scotland's total employment, and represents 31% of Scottish GDP. And Scotland's exports in goods and services to the rest of the UK have increased by 74% since 2002, compared to only 7.8% growth in sales to the EU over the same period. So Scottish exports in goods and services to the UK are increasing at almost 10 times the rate to the rest of the EU. It is clear that the United Kingdom is the most important union for Scotland. By speaking with one voice, we can champion all of the UK's consumers and businesses. Their interests should be at the heart of our discussions. So finally, my department stands ready to help Scottish businesses thrive overseas and to encourage greater investment into Scotland, and we are already doing this. By working together over the coming years, we can ensure we build a global Britain that works for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hands. And before we start, can I say that in the Scottish Parliament, we don't use the term Madam Convener. Convener's perfectly adequate, so thank you very much for your courtesy.
Convener, very good.
Can I open by asking you, given that Scotland voted 62% Remain, where I understand that the UK as a whole voted to leave, however, there's an extremely large body of evidence that shows that even the people who voted to leave did not vote to leave the single market. And this Parliament has voted on a number of occasions to support Scotland remaining within the single market. So can you explain to us why the UK, which was so instrumental in the creation of the single market, has decided against remaining in the European Economic Area?
Right, well, thank you, Kavina. Sorry about the madam. In our parliament, of course, we call, for example, the deputy speaker, madam deputy speaker. So it's good to know proper procedure in your parliament. But can I just say a few things? First of all, I mean, clearly this is the whole of a UK referendum. I pointed out earlier that, for example, my constituency, Chelsea and Fulham in West London, actually voted even more for Remain than Scotland did. Our figures were approximately 70%, and that was not that unusual for parts of London. But the important thing is this was a whole of the UK-wide referendum. That was clear during the campaign. It was clear when the Bill and the Act passed through the Westminster Parliament. In terms of the single market, what we are doing is seeking an ambitious and comprehensive free trade agreement with the EU. Including free-flowing trade in both goods and services that is more ambitious than any other trade deal that we've agreed to date or that anybody has agreed to date. That is what our ambition is. So we want Britain to have the greatest possible tariff and barrier-free trade with our EU neighbours. We want to see zero tariffs on trade in goods and to minimise the regulatory and market access barriers for both goods and services. So in other words, what we're trying to achieve here, and bear in mind, of course, it's a negotiation, so I can only set out what we're trying to achieve at this stage, is to have the fullest possible access to the single market for UK companies.
Very much. Of course, the most successful free trade area in the world is the European single market. The Prime Minister has said that if she would prefer no deal to a bad deal. Do you agree with that?
I think it's important to get a good deal. That is absolutely our ambition. Without wishing to contradict you, I think actually the most successful single market in the world is the United Kingdom single market. And Scotland, by exporting four times as much into the UK single market, I think we can see where the relative importance of those two unions and those two single markets lie. I think it's what we're trying to do, and we are ambitious for the sort of deal that we are seeking to achieve. The negotiation obviously hasn't started yet. As you'll know, Convener, we are triggering Article 50 before the end of next month, that the date is getting, of course, ever closer. And we are looking forward to a successful, productive, fruitful negotiation. I think it's very important to remember that the UK and the EU will remain friends and partners during and after this process. Very important that our cooperation continues, not just on trade matters, but really right the way across the piece in terms of conflict, security, counter-terrorism, all these other things. So I am reasonably optimistic for that negotiation process. I'm not pretending that it will be easy, but our objective is to come to a good terms of departure and to have a full and comprehensive free trade agreement with the European Union, which will come in right away.
The evidence that this committee has taken in Europe and amongst experts has been fairly unanimous in telling us that it's going to be impossible to conclude a trade deal at the same time as the exit deal. And in fact, Professor Sir David Edward, giving evidence to this committee, said the idea that you could secure such a deal within 2 years is for the fairies, was his word. It sounds to me as if you are still insistent that you can negotiate a free trade deal within 2 years when the Europeans are just saying that that's not on and may not even be permissible under Article 50?
Well, that is our ambition. And I think by working together in a common UK effort, we can make that more possible to do that within 2 years. That is very much our ambition, to make sure that we get a deal that works for the whole of the United Kingdom. Not just that, actually a deal that works for the European Union. Now, it's worth remembering that the European Union has a very substantial trade surplus with the United Kingdom, and we think it would be strongly in their interest as well to not have tariffs and other trade barriers between the United Kingdom and the European Union.
Okay. We're, of course, weeks away from triggering Article 50, and the Prime Minister had said that she would continue to consider the Scottish Government's position paper on Scotland's place in Europe. Can you give us some indication of what's going to be in the Article 50 letter and whether it's going to make reference to the position of Scotland as a Remain voting part of the UK? You'll be aware, of course, that the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament has recently said that the position of Scotland should be addressed in the Article 50 negotiations. So is it going to appear in the letter?
Well, I can't comment on what may or may not appear in the letter. What I can say is that our involvement and our interaction with the Scottish Government at all levels has been very strong and will continue to be so. My boss, Dr. Liam Fox, met in August 2016, as early as that, with Keith Brown, who we both know as Cabinet Secretary for Economy. Lord Price met with Paul Wheelhouse on the 2nd of November. We are absolutely committed to continuing ongoing interaction. We are studying the Scottish Government's paper, and I know that was formally submitted to the JMC, I think, in January. That paper is still being studied intensely, and I'm sure Mr. Mundell, coming up next, could probably give you a little bit more steer on that. But the involvement of the Scottish Government and, indeed, the Scottish Parliament in this process, I think, is a very important part of where we go forward from here.
Thank you. The Scottish Government has been very critical of the JMC engagement process, and I understand that Chatham House have said that it's an inadequate way to negotiate the exit from the European Union and the Scottish administration's involvement in those negotiations. Could you perhaps tell me, if you could name one policy area that you have changed as a result of these meetings with Scottish ministers?
Well, I'm not a member of the JMC. Mr. Mundell is a member of the JMC.
You'd had with Scottish ministers.
Put to him. But certainly the importance of Scottish trade for me is of huge importance to these will be of huge importance to these negotiations. When we get started, and that I'm sure will be at the forefront of our minds as we carry out that negotiation.
Can I just ask you again, could you name one policy area that you have adjusted as a result of meetings with Scottish ministers?
Well, the negotiation hasn't actually started yet. So in terms of, like, when you say a policy area, the negotiation hasn't started. The Prime Minister has laid out pretty clearly in a very comprehensive speech in January what the UK's position was on all this, which included strong respect for the Scottish Government. But the negotiation hasn't actually started, so let's give the negotiation a chance, and I'm sure the Scottish Government's views will be fed in into that negotiation in the usual way through the JMC, through the First Minister, the Prime Minister, and also with the Secretary of State, Scott.
I'll hand over now to Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much, and good morning, Minister. You described the role of your department as being to be a participant in the process. While Brexit department may take the lead, clearly the International Trade Department will make the expert contributions in relation to international trade. One of the things that was striking about the White Paper compared with the Prime Minister's speech was there was now more clarity around the government's view of the customs union. I wonder if you could describe for us what the government's view is of the relationship between the UK and the EU going forward in relation to the European Customs Union and what discussions you're having with colleagues around that.
Yeah, well, I think the in terms of the Customs Union, I think the most important thing is the objective to make sure that we have frictionless trade with the European Union. The means of getting there is one aspect that we are open-minded about as we enter these negotiations. I think the most important thing is that the objective here is to ensure that there are no tariffs and no new barriers in place where there are none currently today in our trade relationship with the European Union. The Prime Minister was clear both in the speech and in the White Paper that we don't want to be bound by the EU's common external tariff or participate in the common commercial policy. So I think the most important thing, Lewis, is to think about the objective here rather than necessarily the means of getting there. We've said that we want to come to a customs arrangement with the European Union, but we do not wish to remain members of the customs union. And we've mapped out pretty clearly, to my mind, what we're looking to achieve there in that space.
What I think that I take the point. The objective is where the focus must be. But in order to get there, you need to have the means. And I'm struggling a little with the suggestion that, from a European Union perspective, a tariff-free trading arrangement with the United Kingdom is a given in the way that I think you would appear to imply. So what is the what is the offer, if you like, from the UK in relation to the customs arrangements that the European Union currently has? And secondly, what's the consequence for our existing trade with third countries? At the moment, all our trading arrangements with countries out with Europe are governed by our membership of the European Single Market and the European Customs Union. So what is the consequence for those agreements of withdrawal from the EU?
Right. If I take that in two parts, I think you're asking what would be the EU viewpoint on frictionless trade and tariffs, and secondly, what the implications would be of leaving the customs union on our trade, or the UK's trade, with third countries. So let me take each of those in turn. I think the EU viewpoint, I mean, that's clearly a matter for the European Union, but I think we are confident the EU won't want to do anything that will harm their own trade with the United Kingdom. I mentioned earlier that the EU enjoys a very healthy trade surplus with the UK. Clearly not every member of the other EU 27 has a trade surplus with the UK, and different member states will have different priorities within that trading relationship, that widespread and very integrated trading relationship with the UK. But I think the starting point should be that the EU wouldn't want to do anything to damage its own trade and its own exports with the European Union. Its own really important investment relationship with the UK hundreds of thousands of people in the UK go to work every day for German companies, hundreds of thousands for French companies, etc. And the reverse is the case in those major EU markets. So I think it'd be really for them to speak for themselves, but I think that logically and naturally the EU should have a strong interest in making sure that there are no new trade barriers between the United Kingdom and the European Union. I think in terms of the implications for our existing trading relations with third countries, being outside of the customs union clearly allows us a greater degree of flexibility to come to free trade agreements with key partners outside of the European Union. And that, if you like, is one of the great opportunities provided by Brexit. Now, I'm not sure the video link is working so well, but I think I can see you wanting to come in on that point.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I take that as the... I take the point that that's the objective. I think that the challenge, though, is that on completion of the Article 50 process, our existing trade agreements will fall if we have indeed at that point left the customs union and the single market, and therefore any new agreements will not come into force until they have then been negotiated following the triggering of the completion of the Article 50 process. So it's to understand what your department's perspective is on third-party trade agreements between, for the sake of argument, March 2019 and the completion of negotiations with all those potential trading partners out with Europe?
Well, that will be also part of the negotiation. But again, I think what we're looking to do is to reach an agreement on our future partnership by the time the two-year Article 50 process has concluded. We expect then a phased process of implementation in which both UK and EU institutions and member states prepare for the new arrangements. I think where we go forward from there will be an interesting side of the whole Brexit process, is how we take over, if you like, the EU side of those free trade agreements with third-party countries. And that will be part of the scoping out arrangements that we'll be having with third-party countries between now and the time that Brexit actually happens, as to which parts of those agreements we want to take over, which parts we may seek to improve, which parts we simply translate over. But it's really too early at this stage to say which part and which agreement. That's something that we are studying actively at the moment.
Is it fundamental to both trade with the single market and to future agreements with third parties that there should be common standards and common rules of origin? And is that is aligning the regulations and the rules of origin an objective of the UK government in these negotiations?
Well, some of these things are a careful balance between alignment and the ability to have our own set of standards and regulations that particularly suit the UK, and within that would be all parts of the UK, including the devolved nations. And that'll be a careful part of that balance. Between alignment and the ability to take advantage of the UK being able to set its own standards and regulatory environment. And that'll be part of that process going forward, and that will, by necessity, vary by particular market and by particular trading relationship.
Does that mean that differentiation between British standards and European standards is a process that will start immediately and will, in your objectives, be completed within 2 years?
No, I don't think so. I think right away, clearly we are still in the European Union, we cannot sign, of course, a free trade agreement until we are outside of the European Union. So on that basis, no, I don't see that process starting immediately. I see that being something for the future.
Thank you.
Richard Lockhead.
Thank you. Thank you very much for giving evidence today, Minister. I do feel I should start off with a point of information. The next Scottish independence referendum has not been launched yet. I thought your opening remarks were like the opening speech for the No campaign. But what we really want to talk today about is trade relations with the rest of the world post-Brexit. In her speech, Theresa May, your Prime Minister, said that in relation to her negotiations with Europe, that Europe should respect the differences within that union. There should be flexibility and compromise in terms of negotiations post-Brexit, and she wanted the rest of Europe to respect those differences within the European Union. Can you explain to me how those principles are being adopted in terms of Scotland's view on EU membership, given that 62% of Scots voted to remain within Europe, and the Scottish Government's policy of seeking bespoke solutions to try and maintain our links with Europe and membership of the single market? Should those same principles not apply to the Prime Minister and your government in your dealings with Scotland, as the Prime Minister was asking the rest of Europe to respect?
Well, OK, I mean, I sort of feel I've sort of slightly answered this one already, but I think the important thing, which we've been absolutely clear on, and I think I've demonstrated, is the involvement of the Scottish Government in this whole process and our interactions, very strong and meaningful interactions with the Scottish Government so far. We're studying the Scottish Government's white paper very closely, very intently. Mr. Mundell can probably give you a little bit more detail on that part of the process. I think Scotland is going to be a key and fundamental part to this negotiation from across the UK. But going back to the point about which way Scotland voted in the referendum, you know, I will go back to the example of my own constituency, but it is fundamentally, this is a UK-wide referendum where the UK decided as a United Kingdom by a majority of 1.3 million people. I have to say, as I mentioned earlier, I campaigned on the other side, but nevertheless, more people across the UK voted to leave the European Union than have ever voted for anything else before. So the strong democratic mandate is there, and the best thing for us to do is to now work together and make sure that we deliver a new arrangement, a comprehensive free trade agreement with the European Union as a whole, that benefits all parts of the United Kingdom, all of its constituent parts, including Scotland. And that is the basis on which we need to go forward. And I'm looking forward to working closely, our department is looking forward to working closely with the Scottish Government as we go forward from here. As I understand it, there's a very constructive discussion at the JMC on the 30th of January in relation to how Scotland's trading interests can be taken forward in those discussions, in those negotiations, and also about the continued good work that my department does, working closely with the Scottish Development International to make sure that we deliver good quality services for Scottish businesses and consumers as we go forward from here as well.
In terms, though, of the Scottish Government's policy, widely supported within the Parliament and Scotland, of seeking a bespoke arrangement to maintain Scotland's links with the single market and membership of the single market, you seem very dismissive of any bespoke arrangement for Scotland. So do you not envisage any bespoke arrangement for Scotland to retain membership of the single market?
Well, I wasn't dismissive. I was. I think the access to the single market is extremely important for all parts of the United Kingdom, and that's one of the reasons why we want to maximise our access to the single market and make sure that our trade overall as the United Kingdom is as frictionless as possible. In terms of a differentiation, we've read the Scottish Government paper which was presented, and we are taking the proposal seriously. An official level engagement has intensified to ensure the proposal is considered fully. And feeding into the ongoing engagement through the JMC process. There's a lot that we can agree on already, which is in the white paper. For example, protecting workers' rights, protecting the status of EU citizens currently in the UK, and ensuring Scottish universities have access to the best of European talent. So there's already an enormous amount in that white paper that we agree with and will be taking forward as part of that negotiation. In terms of a differentiation, that is something that we are looking at, and Mr. Mundell can probably give you a little bit more full answer on that.
I hear what you say, and I thank you for that answer, but these are all issues that are in the benefit of the whole of the UK, and what I was asking was, are there any examples of bespoke arrangements for Scotland in light of the Scottish Government's paper? Can I just ask one final question in terms of the trade negotiations? There's a big concern in Scotland that post-Brexit, as negotiations proceed, there may be a decline in standards of imported goods to this country, because quite clearly the UK will have to negotiate with Europe and also third-party countries. Can you give a guarantee to the committee there will be no decline in standards of goods and services in this country as a result of the post-Brexit negotiations?
Well, I'm not sure if I understand the question. In terms of like a decline in standards, well, at the moment we are obviously still members of the European Union. So whilst we are members of the European Union, there is no change in any standards.
Exit in your strategy.
But beyond that, well, it's very important that the UK maintains its standards. We've given a very, very strong commitments in terms of areas like workers' rights, in terms of food standards. I've got a whole set of manifesto commitments in some of these spaces as well. So I think it would be wrong to say there will be a decline in standards as a result of Brexit on imported goods. Actually, what this allows us to do is to come to free trade agreements for the UK with third-party markets that will be to the benefit of UK producers and UK consumers. All of the free trade, it's important the free trade agreements do not infringe on any individual country's right to regulate, which includes standards on things like food and other products. That won't be changed, that the UK and where appropriate of old administrations will have the right to regulate those products. That won't change.
Thank you. Before I move to Jackson Carlow, Minister, I'd just like a quick supplementary on something that you mentioned there. You mentioned the university sector. You'll be aware of the report in the Times, which obtained a government report on the government's priorities, which had education as a low priority. Now, given the amount of evidence that we've taken in this committee about the importance of universities to the Scottish economy, detailing them as a low priority is a cause of great concern and seems to directly contradict what you've just said there about listening to the Scottish Government's concerns.
Well, I disagree with that. I mean, the Chancellor of the Exchequer here has been absolutely clear in guaranteeing Horizon 2020 funding up to the year 2020, and that has been the clearest signal. That's one of the very first things that we did.
After we leave is the concern, and universities have been designated a low priority by your government.
Well, I disagree, because I think we've shown from our actions that one of the very first things that we did last August was to guarantee Horizon 2020 funding as we move forward.
Yes,
so
you've said that,
but judge us by our actions rather than an article.
No,
in the
we're
Times.
Talking about after we leave the European Union, and you have designated universities as low priority.
Well, no, I'm pointing out to you the high priority that we attach to universities right the way across the United Kingdom. Some of the world's very best universities are in the United Kingdom, in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK. And actually, they are a very important part of our free trading future. When you look at some of our key markets, like, for example, the United States, but also key markets like the European Union, like China and others, the fact the UK has world-leading universities is not only desirable, but is absolutely essential for some of our key sectors. If you look at like the UK thriving life sciences business, I was actually out on the west coast of the States just a few weeks ago and actually talking to a company that is going to be setting up more operations in Edinburgh. And one of the things that attracted them to Edinburgh was the quality of the university offer in Edinburgh. The life sciences sector as a whole is incredibly attractive to UK universities. The whole cluster around Cambridge, for example, is another example. So in all of these, in terms of our free trading future, universities are going to be absolutely at the centre of that.
Okay.
And they are one of our strongest cards as we go forward from here.
OK, thanks. So still being categorised low priority. OK, Jackson Carlow.
Good morning, Minister. You used the expression frictionless. You used the expression frictionless trade, and I also noted you saying we want no new barriers where there are none today in our trading relationship with the EU. And you also then went on earlier to describe the balance of trade that exists within the United Kingdom as opposed to Scotland's trade with the rest of the European Union, and the value, therefore, of the UK market to us all. I'm wondering then, in any hypothetical differentiated settlement that might arise for Scotland, what intended or unintended consequences do you think might arise or have to be resolved with regard to trade within the UK as a result of that?
Well, I think the most important thing to do in all of this is to make sure, when we look at anything like differentiation, is to make sure that trade within the United Kingdom is not harmed or infringed or made more difficult. When you look at the top trading partners, I'm looking at Scotland-only statistics, which come from the Scottish Government Global Connections Survey 2015, which show that in Scotland's top five trading partners, the rest of the UK, at a value of £49.8 billion, a share of total exports of 63%. The next closest market is the United States at £4.5 billion, which is less than a tenth of the amount of exports going from Scotland that there are to the UK. So clearly any consideration of differentiation will have to ensure that we do not create a difficulty for trade within the United Kingdom. That, I think we would all agree, is or should be a paramount concern for Scottish businesses and consumers.
We've heard, thank you for that. We've heard evidence as a committee of the arrangements that obtain between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, which of course arise historically and of course reflect the unique status in Ireland. And some have argued that that arrangement is therefore one which is directly transferable to the United Kingdom, and any differentiated settlement here could use that as its base model. Do you see that as being a directly transferable option?
Well, I think in terms of that, I think that might be a question, again, better put to Mr. Mundell. But clearly, we have stated in terms of the Irish border that is one of the top priorities. That's one of Theresa May's top 12 priorities for that negotiation, is finding a way to make sure that that border works in a way that it has been doing so, and to make sure that there's no damage to that trade as well. So I don't directly see that as being an example that could be transferred over.
Thank you.
Thank you, Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Ruth Davidson made a statement at the National Farmers Union meeting last Monday, saying, currently we have one Scottish Development International office in the whole of Latin America, and as we get ready for Brexit, she said that she thinks we should be doing more to ensure that we're ready to take advantage of such emerging markets. So I'm curious that we've got a really successful market in the EU on our doorstep. So how much importance would we be putting on focusing on distant markets with environmental impacts, transport, freshness? These are just simple things when we should be focusing on markets close to our nearest neighbours, because, as Convener said, the EU market is the most successful.
Well, the first thing I'd say to that is, of course, Scotland's nearest neighbour is England. And the importance of that market, I think, is the rest of the UK as a whole when talking about proximity. But I think in terms of the opportunities for Scottish business beyond the European continent, I think is extremely interesting. And that's exactly the sort of thing that we want to be maximising. We already work very closely together as a department with Scottish Development International. Whenever I go on my different visits to different markets, I quite often see the Scottish Development International people. I can think recently, for example, I was in Taiwan in September and had made sure that Scottish Development International were there in the meeting that I had prior to the negotiation I was going into with the Taiwanese authorities, in terms of securing a good deal for Scotch whisky in Taiwan, which is an extremely important market. And we engage very, very widely. I mean, for example, recently the South Korean firm CS Wind, that was a Department for International Trade engagement for their commitment securing, safeguarding 70 jobs in Campbelltown through building of the new offshore wind tower facility there as well. So I think as we go forward, We have people in 100 and I think 100 over 100 markets represented by the Department of International Trade. We have one of the best international networks out there. We are already engaging on a huge number of markets. Ministers have been to more than 50 different markets since the formation of the department last July, making sure that Scottish exports have got a strong voice out there, and also making sure that foreign direct investment comes in Scotland. In 2015, for example, Scotland secured a total of 119 foreign direct investment projects, which made Scotland the second most attractive region in the UK, behind only London. So our officials are engaging very, very strongly, both in their own right, and working very closely with Scottish Development International. And that's exactly what we want to see continuing.
Much. Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move to the issue of EU workers in Scotland. They clearly have an impact on our ability to trade successfully, and we believe at the moment there are over 180,000 EU citizens in Scotland. The committee has heard evidence previously about the uncertainty that people are facing in that position, and the UK government has stated that you'd like to address the status of those EU citizens in the UK at the earliest opportunity, while ultimately reducing future EU migration. So concerns have been raised that administrative procedures aren't in place to identify those EU citizens already resident and to process any applications they may need to make secure permanent residency. And we're already seeing incidences where people are being asked to leave erroneously. So, Mr. Hands, I'd like to ask if you're comfortable with the level of uncertainty and insecurity EU citizens in Scotland are currently facing.
Well, let me take that question head on. I have to say my constituency in London, 17% of my constituents are EU nationals, which I think is the highest in the whole of the United Kingdom. I'm married to an EU national, so these issues are very close to home. And I think the UK government is following exactly the right approach in setting out to one of the earliest, first things that we do is coming to an agreement to guarantee the status of EU nationals currently in the UK, as well as guaranteeing the status of UK subjects within the European Union as well. That's what we are confidently expecting to happen very soon in that negotiation. So I am confident that their status will be sorted out. Because, let's face it, they make a massive contribution to our society, to our economy. The 3 million EU nationals are certainly a large part of my constituency wouldn't be able to function without them. You say 180,000 EU citizens in Scotland. I can tell you that in London, the impact of EU citizens leaving would be very severe indeed on the London economy and London's society as a whole. So I think as we move forward, I think that's one of the things that we should be able to agree quite quickly. The Prime Minister has been absolutely clear on that. David Davis has been clear on that. And then beyond there, the most important thing is that the UK will have control of immigration policy and will be able to make the decisions that suit the UK as a whole in relation to immigration. And that's entirely properly the best way that these things are done.
I appreciate the Minister appears to be taking this issue very seriously indeed, but will the UK government simply not clarify the status of EU citizens living here and take them off the negotiating table?
Well, it's important also for us to look after the rights of British citizens, which will include a large number from Scotland, within the European Union. As well. It would not be right for us to ignore their rights as well. But I don't think it would be in either side's interest. This is, I think one has to understand the common interest here between, you know, we are going to remain friends, the UK and the European Union. We work very, very, we currently work very closely together. We will continue to work very, very closely together. It is, in my mind, inconceivable that either side would want to jeopardize the status of 5 million people. I mentioned my own family. There's hundreds of thousands of families up and down the UK who would have that impact, and also in other EU countries. That is why I'm very hopeful, confident that we will come to an early agreement. Nobody is jeopardising anybody's status. Quite the opposite. The UK government will be going in early to make sure that those status is guaranteed as we move forward. And that's exactly the right thing to do.
I think it would be very helpful if the UK could give leadership on this issue. I don't think we have to wait on others. We could take a decisive stand here. Can I just ask one final question, Convener? Is the UK government willing to concede that freedom of movement is essential and likely non-negotiable in any transitional phase?
Sorry, if freedom of movement is not negotiable in terms of... Well, I think the European Union, from what the European different interlocutors of the European Union said, that the four pillars, the four parts of the EU single market stand together, which is why... Theresa May in her speech in January in the government's white paper has said that we're not setting out an approach of cherry-picking in this. But we've also been clear that the UK will be taking back control of the immigration policy in full. And we'll have to see. But, you know, the UK will be able to set its own immigration policy, which I think will be a very, very important thing to go forward from here. But can I just come back to your early nationals? See, I don't think there's any... a degree of uncertainty that's out there. I think the UK government has been absolutely clear that it's one of our earliest and most important priorities, and we would expect it to be agreed very, very quickly. I don't think it is in either side's interest to jeopardise or indeed call into question the status of what is a total of 5 million people. When you think about the magnitude of that would be huge. And I don't think that the EU would also want to jeopardise the status of 2 million British people, including a large number of people in Scotland, who are in other EU countries.
Phil Hamilton.
Good morning, Mr. Hands. Can I just bring you back to trade, since we have that opportunity within this committee today? As you'll be aware, whisky is one of Scotland's most important exports to the world. And Scotch whisky is the single biggest net contributor to the UK's balance of trade in goods. The industry body, the Scottish Whisky Association, has been clear about its approach to Brexit, and I'd just like to quote them. They say, in many markets, Scotch will also continue to benefit from existing zero tariffs, for example, in the US, Canada and Mexico, as these are offered to all countries already. In many other markets that already demand high tariffs, for example, India, Brexit will not make the situation any worse. I just wondered how your role in the UK government as a trade minister will make the best use of these trade opportunities to the Scotch whisky industry and other industries too.
Yeah, well, we work very closely with the Scotch Whisky Association. My boss, Liam Fox, when he was in Scotland last August, one of his public meetings, the Scottish government, probably his second most important meeting, was with the Scotch Whisky Association. And we make sure, I mentioned, for example, the trade talks I did with Taiwan, which, if I'm not mistaken, I think is the fourth largest export market for Scotch whisky, and making sure I had quite long and detailed discussions with the Taiwanese authorities about the lot codes on Scotch whisky bottles, which is a key concern for the industry in Taiwan, making sure that those lot codes remain intact and sacrosanct in that process. But we are, of course, keenly aware of the importance of the industry. Scotch whisky, for example, is protected in Canada as a registered geographical indicator, which, again, is something which was negotiated directly with Canada. I think the importance of trade for Scotch whisky as a whole, I mean, 93% of Scotch whisky production is exported. And last year, the total value of that export trade reached $3.999 billion. It must have been perhaps just a few bottles short of reaching the $4 billion figure, which was up from $3.845 billion in 2015. And by the way, single malt Scotch whisky exports topped $1 billion for the first time in 2016. The US, for example, I think you mentioned, remained the biggest market of all for the value of sales, and that rose from $749 million to $854 million And we go into bat very regularly and comprehensively for the industry, and that will clearly continue. And we do that in conjunction, making sure that we talk to interested stakeholders in Scotland as well, not only the producers, but also the Scottish Government and Scottish Development International as well.
Thank you. I'm sure the Scottish whisky industry will be very pleased to hear your work that you're doing and will continue to do.
Thank you. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Before I start, I think the Minister would like to reflect upon your comments from a few moments ago when you spoke about Scotland and foreign direct investment, when you referred to Scotland as a region. In fact, Scotland is a country. And bearing in mind the language that's been used in the past of a family of nations and a respect agenda. So I'm quite sure you'd like to reflect upon your comments. But the first question is regarding the WTO. And the Minister, you'll be aware that it can take some time for WTO schedules to be discussed and certified. And in terms of that, how do you anticipate, and also what schedules would you anticipate the UK government would consider in terms of any negotiations it would take forward?
Well, let me, of course I recognise that Scotland as a nation. My mother's from Scotland, and I've got a large number of relatives in Edinburgh who I think may even be watching this committee broadcast today. So, but let me answer your question. In terms of the WTO, in leaving the EU, we need to update the terms of our WTO membership, where at present our commitments are applied through the European Union as a whole. The UK, of course, is a founding member of the WTO, or its predecessor agreement, or its predecessor organisation. And we need to make sure that the UK has its own independent schedules at the WTO, which at the moment will be simply transferring over the European Union schedules to be in the UK's name without any change. Any future change that would happen there would have to go through the UK Parliament, where, of course, Scotland has representation as well.
In terms of any further discussions with the WTO and attempting to get a longer term set of agreements, do you have any anticipation of the length of time that would actually take? So I'm conscious that there was a time delay in terms of the EU enlargement and, when they went to EU 25 in 2004. And that agreement was certified in December of 2016. So it doesn't tend to be a short-term process to get WTO agreements in place.
Well, I think if it's okay with you, if I can write to you on the change that you mentioned in terms of the WTO rule, the WTO from 2000. Can I undertake to write to the committee via?
Yes. Yeah, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
So also, just in terms of the WTO, this committee had commissioned some research from the Fraser of Allender Institute, and in the document, there's a number of points that were raised and suggesting regarding the WTO model of potentially real wages expected to be 7% lower. Which is equivalent to a reduction of around £2,000 per year, and also a GDP expected to be over 5% lower than would otherwise have been the case, and exports over 11% lower, because WTO tariffs obviously are a lot more stringent and more challenging as compared to what we've actually had with the EU. So in terms of the trade, I heard what you said earlier on regarding the work that the UK government have been undertaking, but nonetheless, under trade agreements under WTO rules are anticipated to be a lot more challenging and potentially have that negative effect, and potentially up to 80,000 jobs to be lost in Scotland as well. So what would the UK government attempt to do, and how would you attempt to deal with the negative effects with the WTO rules?
Well, our objective is not to have tariffs at all. That's the important thing to understand here in terms of the negotiation of a comprehensive free trade agreement with the European Union is to have that frictionless trade and tariff-free trade and to make sure that that happens. And that is what all our efforts are being put towards. That is why we are engaging with the Scottish Government to make sure that we work together to make sure that not only do we get reasonable terms of departure, but also the terms of trade with the European Union in the future, which I talked about earlier at some length in terms of where I see the strong common interest that there is between both the United Kingdom and the European Union in making sure that we have that frictionless tariff-free trade, which would avoid these questions entirely. That is our objective. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm confident that we are going to achieve that.
Certainly, the objective is something that I'm quite sure most people would want to agree on. It's also been suggested as well that in the longer term, there would actually be an average of 2% increase in trade tariffs under the WTO scenario. So an objective is one thing, but also entering into discussions and then a final outcome can be totally different.
Well, again, I return to the importance. First of all, it's our objective to avoid any tariffs in place, in a place where there is currently a tariff-free trade between ourselves and the European Union. The other thing that I would say is just the importance of the United Kingdom as a market for Scottish goods. I mentioned those figures earlier, that anybody who's thinking of breaking up that union, I think would also need to answer questions as to precisely the 63% of Scottish exports that go to the rest of the United Kingdom compared to the only 15% that go to the European Union. That would be, I think, quite an interesting question for perhaps somebody to have a real study as to what the implications there might be for leaving the United Kingdom in terms of trade and exports and outward investment coming into Scotland. I think that situation would be absolutely catastrophic. And that, I think, is also a very relevant consideration as we move forward.
But similar to the Minister, I'm quite sure that you wouldn't want to jeopardise the £63 billion of goods that Scotland buys from the rest of the UK.
I didn't hear the question properly.
I'm quite sure you wouldn't want to jeopardise the £63 billion worth of goods and services that Scotland buys from the rest of the UK, if you're considering that using the language of a frictionless agreement.
I think in which case we can both agree on the importance of avoiding tariffs then with the European Union as well, and making sure that we have good trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK and between the UK as a whole with the other EU 27 members. And I return to the point I made earlier, which is, you know, throughout all of this, we're going to be friends, we're going to remain friends. The UK and the EU need each other. We've got such a strong common interest in the world, not just in terms of our economies, but in terms of our trade picture, but also far beyond that. That's why I'm fundamentally an optimist in this process, that the negotiation will go well, will end up well, and we'll get to a good agreement and be able to have that frictionless trade and have a comprehensive free trade agreement with the European Union, which will suit the whole of the UK, including Scotland as well.
Just on that final point, convener, just in terms of the frictionless trade and remaining friends, can I gently urge you to speak to some of your colleagues, because some of the language that some of your colleagues have been using regarding our European friends and historical events are not making friends, are not keeping friends in the European Union. And that certainly was a point that was raised with members of this committee when we went to Brussels only a few weeks ago. And that point was raised to us by multiple people. So I would gently ask you to speak to your colleagues.
Well, I think, why don't we make a deal here? Why don't we both speak to our colleagues I will speak to any Conservative MPs who might be felt to have said things that have upset people. You could perhaps have a word with your members of Parliament down here in Westminster who on the Monday did not oppose CETA in a vote in the House of Commons, yet on Wednesday voted en masse to oppose the comprehensive economic trade agreement with Canada, which I can tell you did not go down well in either the European Union or with our key Canadian partners as we go forward. That perhaps if you could have a word with them as well, then we've got a deal.
I'll happily speak to my colleagues anytime.
Thank you. Just to, in a supplementary on this comprehensive free trade deal that you say you will negotiate with the European Union within 2 years, is it going to cover services and agriculture? Because most free trade deals do not.
Well, that will remain to be seen. But I think we would want it to be, when I say comprehensive, we would clearly want to be have as many sectors within that deal as we reasonably could, whilst keeping the parameters of being able to negotiate it within the time frame. What we have said is we want that deal to be the most comprehensive free trade agreement that anybody has yet negotiated in the world. So clearly we want to have the maximum number of sectors within that deal that would be consistent with being able to negotiate and agree and deliver the deal and have it ratified.
And so will that include agriculture and services?
Well, services are extremely important to the UK economy as a whole. 80% of GDP, 79% of jobs right the way across the UK. Agriculture is a massively important sector in Scotland and across the United Kingdom. But precisely what goes into that FTA, we will have to see. But I just repeat that we want it to be as comprehensive and all-encompassing as we can get.
So you can't tell us whether these two key sectors of the economy are going to be included in this free trade deal, which most observers say that you can't negotiate within 2 years?
Well, Kavina, I would say it is, of course, a negotiation, so I can't tell you anything of what will definitely be agreed at the end of the negotiation.
But surely you should have, we're weeks away from triggering Article 50, surely you should have a position in place.
I can tell you what the scale of the UK ambition is. For that FTA, for it to be as comprehensive and all-encompassing as possible. I'm not going to state today which sectors would definitely be in and which sectors would definitely not be in, but I think you can see from the direction of travel that the size of those sectors would be so large that inevitably they will be part of our consideration.
Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Minister. In the course of the evidence, you've talked about maintaining common standards with the current European standards that apply, and also about inheriting the WTO schedules that we currently have as a member of the European Union. You will understand the important role of the Court of Justice of the European Union in interpreting and applying standards in relation to trade. And I wonder, therefore, whether you feel that the government's apparent determination to disengage with the Court of Justice of the European Union, whether that limits the scope of any potential agreement, either in the customs area or in relation to the single market.
Well, what I would say to that is that common to all free trade agreements is an ability to assess standards and an ability to enforce standards in the areas where it is appropriate and the areas that are within the agreement. So leaving the jurisdiction of the ECJ does not prevent us from having a common assessment of standards in the same way that any other free trade agreement will have a process for determining what those standards are, a process for determining how one can challenge something which one thinks is not in accordance with the free trade agreement, not in accordance with those standards. That would be what I would expect to happen in this.
And can you tell us today how you envisage that process being designed? Clearly, the ECJ has the final word, if you like, in interpretation of the rules within the European Union. The UK Supreme Court has a parallel role here, but in any trade agreement, there presumably has to be a third source of authority that is accepted by both parties. What do you envisage that source of authority might be?
Well, I think it's too early to predict that, but what I would say is that both parties, I'm sure, will have a strong interest in making sure that trade flows and making sure that common standards, where appropriate, are agreed. You've got to remember that within this process, it's a little bit different to negotiating a free trade agreement to bring down barriers where there are currently barriers. Here we are talking about a free trade agreement that will preserve barrier-free trade. And that is a rather different proposition when we go into this negotiation. It's impossible for me to say where that negotiation will lead. All I can say is that that strong common interest in trade between the United Kingdom and the European Union, the fact that 44% of our exports as a whole from the UK, about the same figure for Scotland, go to the European Union when in terms of our global exports, and the fact the EU has got a substantial trade surplus with the United Kingdom as well, I think gives me a confidence that we will come to a good agreement to make sure that there's frictionless tariff-free trade between the United Kingdom and the Europe. But clearly, it's a negotiation. So before the negotiations have even begun, I cannot guarantee you what that negotiation will deliver. All I can guarantee you is that the EU enter into that negotiation seeking to represent the whole of the United Kingdom in conjunction and working closely with the Scottish Government, with the other devolved administrations as well, and making sure that everybody's voice is heard around that table and that we get the best possible agreement to deliver for the whole of the United Kingdom.
Thank you. We're just going to wind up now. Just before you go, Mr. Hands, your previous engagement with this Parliament was in terms of your role with the Treasury, and the, you have considerable expertise in the fiscal framework that operates between Scotland and the UK in terms of transfer of funds. Scotland currently gets 16% of the Common Agricultural Policy funds. How do you foresee that 16% of Common Agricultural Policy funds being transferred to Scotland after we leave the European Union?
Well, that's if I can sort of pledge, I think that's going to be a matter for the Treasury and for the Department for Agriculture, Fisheries and Rural Affairs, DEFRA, that'll be a matter for them. But I think the most important thing is that we have obviously guaranteed the funding for the Common Agricultural Policy up to 2020, and making sure that that is delivered equitably, I'm sure, will be done in conjunction in the proper way with the Scottish Government as we go forward.
Equitably, or the 16% that we currently get? Is that what you mean by equitably?
I think that'll be a matter which perhaps could be best put to others. That's not, strictly speaking, within the remit of the Department for International Trade. I think you're perhaps asking me, trying to lure me back onto ground that was perhaps more relevant for HM Treasury. But thank you for referring to my previous engagement. I did enjoy appearing before your two sister committees this time about a year ago. And I'm sure that engagement will continue.
OK, well, thank you very much, Mr. Hands, and we will just have a short suspension before going to the next evidence session. Thank you. We now continue the evidence session, and I welcome the Right Honourable David Mundell MP, Secretary of State for Scotland. Mr Mundell, can I start by thanking you for your patience and apologise that we're running slightly behind time, and can I invite you to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. I'm pleased to be here today to discuss the progress of the Government's work to take forward the referendum decision to leave the EU. I'm aware the committee has just completed a session with my colleague, the Minister for Trade and Investment, on the vital work being taken forward to ensure the UK secures the strongest possible trading relationships with the EU and the rest of the world. And I'd like to give a short update on other aspects of the Government's work. Since I last appeared before the committee in October, we've seen significant developments. Prime Minister's speech at Lancaster House and the subsequent White Paper set out 12 principles that will shape the government's approach and strategy. One of these core principles is strengthening the UK and delivering a deal that secures the specific interests of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. I think it's important to be clear, though, because there's been a lot of public debate on this point, that Scotland will not be in the EU at the end of this process. There is no set of circumstances in which Scotland could remain a member of the EU after the rest of the UK has left. If Scotland's constitutional position were ever to change, it would have to apply to be a member of the EU afresh, and we should not make easy assumptions about the length of time this would take, the process Scotland would have to follow, or the terms of membership that might be on offer. The Scottish Government published their paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, in December. I've made it clear that I recognise this as a serious contribution to the debate, and serious work is underway to consider it, as I've set out in my letter yesterday to committee members. In addition, the Secretary of State for exiting the EU will meet with Michael Russell today for a further discussion. Close engagement with the devolved administrations remains a top priority for the UK government, and this will continue to be the case following the triggering of Article 50 as we move into the next stage of work to leave the EU. We've also seen the introduction of the Article 50 bill and the completion of its passage through the House of Commons. It's currently being considered by the House of Lords, and subject, of course, to the completion of the bill's parliamentary passage, Article 50 will be triggered by the end of March. Looking forward, the Great Repeal Bill will be included in the Queen's speech. This important piece of legislation will provide legal certainty by ensuring that whatever, wherever practical and appropriate, the same rules and laws will apply on the day after we leave the EU as they did on the day before. The government will bring a white paper forward providing more detail on that bill in due course. This legal certainty will be extremely important for business, the public sector and people here in Scotland, and we need to work closely with the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to provide it. Engagement with sectors across Scotland continues to be a top priority for the government. Lord Dunlop and I have now held over 100 such meetings to ensure that we are fully taking into account the priorities and issues for Scotland as the UK prepares for negotiations. Most recently, I held two very productive roundtables with the business community and with academics and constitutional experts on Thursday of last week. These are complex issues, and there remains much work ahead to deliver a smooth, orderly exit from the EU. I greatly welcome the committee's reports to a date with which we will formally issue a response, and look forward to a continued engagement with the committee.
Thank you very much, Secretary of State. Since you last appeared before the committee, as you say, the Scottish Government has published its place on Scotland's place in Europe, and this Parliament has endorsed the principles of that. This Parliament has also voted against triggering Article 50. And You say in your letter that you have been engaging in a productive way with the Scottish Government. Certainly the evidence that we have received from the Scottish Government doesn't back that up. For example, Mr Russell, when he came before the committee, said that the JMCEN meetings tended to be arranged without a great deal of input from the devolved administrations. They had very little control over the agendas. The officials confirmed that the papers came in late. And in his most recent letter about the last JMCEN, he said, "I was not content with the proposed work programme for the JMCEN programme. It was presented to me, I felt it lacked focus on Article 50. And he said that a joint communique was not agreed at the meeting. That doesn't, taking all that together, it doesn't sound as if there is a great deal of respect coming from the UK government towards either the Scottish Government's position or indeed the Scottish Parliament."
I completely refute that. Firstly, as I've set out in my letter, there's been, in the last couple of weeks, there have been six substantive meetings involving Scottish Government and UK Government officials, which have looked at in detail at the proposals which are in the Scottish Government's paper. They've looked at ways in which some of the proposals could be taken forward to achieve the outcome in different ways. They've looked at the legal basis for the proposals. This is substantive work, and I do find it, I have to say, offensive, the way, and I raised this at that last JMC, that Mr Russell dismisses the efforts of officials in both the UK Government and Scottish Government who are doing sterling work in taking forward a very difficult task. Now, we may have political disagreements. Of course, we're going to have political disagreements. But to dispute the fact that there is substantive work going on in this area, substantive work in terms of considering the Scottish Government's proposals, is simply not the case.
I see. Well, Mr Russell brought along one of his senior officials with him who confirmed, in fact, it was the official that said that the papers came in very late and they didn't have a good notice of the agenda. So he didn't seem to think that it was working well.
Convener, I think we've all attended meetings where papers have come in very late. Papers coming in very late, I don't think, suggests that there isn't serious engagement.
Well, we're talking about, you know, the biggest constitutional change in this country since the Second World War. So it's not just the Scottish Government that say that the process is flawed. If I can quote Chatham House recently brought out a report on the interaction between the UK Government and devolved administrations, and it says the institutional arrangement for decision-making between the UK Government and devolved administrations, the GMC, is not suited to developing a joint position on leaving the EU. That's Chatham House on devolved external affairs.
I'm sure Chatham House is entitled to set out their opinion. When the GMC met at the end of January in Cardiff, I think all the participants in the course of the meeting, the First Minister of Scotland, the First Minister of Wales, First Minister of Northern Ireland and the leader of Sinn Féin, acknowledged that that meeting had provided a basis for setting out a full and frank exchange of views, of setting out, certainly in relation to Scotland, a decision which has been followed through of intensifying the discussions in relation to the Scottish Government's paper. So I regard that meeting as a productive meeting. I don't dispute the challenges that come in such an environment where some of the protagonists are coming from radically different perspectives, but it is an opportunity for a full and frank exchange of views, and that's what took place.
You can have a full and frank exchange of views, but that doesn't mean to say that you're going to move forward. How are you changing your position as a result of hearing the views from Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland? Could you name a change in the last few weeks as a result of hearing those robust views?
What I can say is that this has been an evolving process. So that evolved through the Prime Minister's speech and through the White Paper. One area which I can say is included as one of the Prime Minister's 12 priorities as a direct result of input from Scotland, and the Prime Minister herself has acknowledged that, is on item 10, that ensuring that the UK remains the best place for science and innovation. There was very, very strong representations from Scotland in relation to that issue, and that shaped that part of the Prime Minister's setting out of priorities and is included in the White Paper. Within the White Paper as well, and within the speech, there were a whole range of views and which are actually reflected in the Scottish Government's paper. Issues on workers' rights, issues on sharing of information in terms of criminal justice and security. There are many, many of the points which are in that paper, which are reflected in the White Paper. There is a huge amount of common ground. And even where there is some political dispute, actually, in most cases, the objective is the same. And that's one of the things that our officials are currently discussing to whether, you know, whether we get to the same objective by different routes.
Yeah. You paint a very rosy picture, but the fact is this Parliament voted against triggering Article 50.
I acknowledge that, and I acknowledge the right of this Parliament to have a debate and to express its views on that matter. When I was a member of this Parliament, and I think Mr. Scott was at that time, we had a very, and Mr. Lockhead too, we had a very, and indeed you, Mr. MacDonald as well, I look around the table. We had a very lively and full debate on the UK's participation in the war in Iraq, and that was an important opportunity for people to express views, but ultimately the responsibility for foreign affairs in the devolved arrangement rests with the UK government.
Okay, you say you've been listening. The Article 50 letter is very soon going to be given to the EU from the Prime Minister. What reference is there going to be to Scotland in that Article 50 letter?
The Article 50 letter hasn't been finalised in terms of the structure of that letter. I'm sure the Scottish Government's input to that letter may well be part of Mr. Russell's discussions with Mr. Davis today. It'll certainly be part of the discussions the next time the JMCEN meet.
Right, but can you tell us, I mean, you are Scotland's representative in London, although many people say that you're the UK government's person in Scotland.
Well, I don't...
You should know if Scotland is going to be in that letter.
Convener, I don't think that that actually is an appropriate remark from somebody who's a convener of a committee in this Parliament.
Well, can you tell us if Scotland is going to be in the letter? The point I'm making is that you should know, as you're the person who's we're relying on to advance Scotland's position and Scotland voted Remain.
What I can give you an assurance is that Scotland's interests will be represented in the letter. The situation with the letter is that a final decision on the exact nature of the letter hasn't been made. But Scotland's position will not in any way be prejudiced by the way in which that letter is set out. And I, as you rightly say, it is my responsibility within the UK government to ensure that Scotland's interests are represented, and I will make sure they are in terms of the drafting of that letter. But I can't set out to you what will be in that letter at this time, because the letter has not been drafted.
And will it ask for a differentiated position for Scotland that reflects the 62% of people who voted to remain in Scotland?
Well, I think, again, we could go down a route which is well rehearsed of the fact that, firstly, the vote in Scotland was a vote as to whether the United Kingdom remained in the EU, Scotland having voted to remain within the United Kingdom. Secondly, the position is that we have given a serious commitment to look at the proposals for a differentiated settlement. I remain to be convinced in that regard, but I am still open-minded in relation to bringing forward evidence that the position for a differentiated settlement is in fact to the benefit of Scotland and the economy, not driven by any particular ideology, but for the benefit of Scotland and its economy, and that's what we continue to look at. So we're still engaged in that process.
Richard Lockhead.
I want to return to the theme of how you're representing Scotland's interests, because you were the only Scottish MP that voted to trigger Article 50. We have a government in Scotland, we have a parliament in Scotland, we had the result of the referendum in Scotland where 62% of people voted to remain within the EU. And most people, I would hope we agree, who even voted to leave the EU probably thought we're going to stay in the single market, or at least maintain very strong links with the single market. Yet you voted for Article 50. Can you give us an example of how you're representing Scotland's interests? You were the only MP in Scotland that voted to trigger Article 50.
I've set out clearly my rationale for doing that. I voted to remain. That was my view. But the overall result in the United Kingdom was to leave the EU. And I'm a Democrat, and I accept that result. And as I've said many times before, in 2004, the result of the independence referendum had been a yes vote, I would have accepted that vote and worked to make an independent Scotland a success. I wouldn't have campaigned to change. I wouldn't have campaigned to change the vote. So, as a Democrat, I accept that was a UK-wide decision, and the vote was for the UK to leave the EU. What we need to do is to leave on the best possible terms that secures the best outcome for Scotland's economy and the people of Scotland and the wider UK.
Okay, but we've got a Secretary of State for Brexit, we've got a Secretary of State for Trade, the UK government, we've got a Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs, but you're the Secretary of State for Scotland. What's different about your position to the rest of the UK politicians in terms of your job, which is to stand up and represent Scotland? Because there's no evidence that you've given to this committee or we've heard in the public domain of what is taken on board in terms of Scotland's vote. 62% of Scots voted to remain in Europe.
62% of people in Scotland voted for the United Kingdom to remain in Europe, Mr. Lockhead. I voted to remain in the EU. I didn't do it on the basis that somehow, if I didn't get my way, then we would reopen the whole constitutional debate about whether or not Scotland should be independent, which seems to be the line that some of your colleagues have been very keen to take. My job is to look at an assessment of the issues as they affect Scotland. In terms of access to the single market, I'm quite clear that the issues as affect Scotland are the same as they affect the whole of the rest of the UK. So therefore, an arrangement which allows frictionless access, barrier-free, tariff-free access to that market is the best for Scotland and the best for the whole of the UK. On the other significant issue of migration, my view is that that is an issue that impacts on the whole of the United Kingdom. And therefore, the arrangements that follow on from leaving the EU are as significant to areas of the United Kingdom, other areas of the United Kingdom, as they are to Scotland. And I think you've previously raised issues, for example, around seasonal workers. You know, there are more seasonal workers in the east of England than the whole of Scotland. So seasonal workers is an important issue at UK level. The issue which is very distinct for Scotland, and an issue which I have highlighted, I mentioned it the last time I was here, will be what happens to powers which are currently exercised in Brussels when they return to the United Kingdom. And there is a very, very distinct Scottish interest in that regard. But even in relation to the first two issues that I set out, I've been very clear that I am still open-minded in relation to the proposals that the Scottish Government have brought forward, if they can be evidenced that there is actually some differential arrangement that would be beneficial to Scotland.
But can you not help the Scottish Government reach that position if you think that's in Scotland's interests? You're saying that you want more detail, you want more evidence, the clock's ticking, Article 50 is about to be triggered in a few weeks' time. Are you just playing along and going through the motions and stringing along the Scottish Government?
We're absolutely doing that. We're working at official level, we're working very constructively with the Scottish Government, and we'll come to a point, there will come a point where we see what we agree on and what we don't agree on. I haven't, and I've said this several times before, I haven't seen evidence myself that I think demonstrates that Scotland would benefit from a differential arrangement, but I'm still open-minded on that regard, because on these two big issues in relation to migration and in relation to access to the single market, I think the resolution that we get across the UK is the one that would be best in Scotland.
Ms. McDonald now.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you, Secretary of State. When Parliament voted on these matters, it voted, I think, called for the UK Government to give serious consideration to what's been proposed by the Scottish Government, and clearly you've laid out in your letter some substantial work that's been undertaken since that vote over the last 2 weeks. Can you tell us at this stage what conclusions the UK government is coming to? I think you said in response to the last question that you had yet to see any evidence that supported a differentiated solution. Can you tell us what evidence has been gleaned from this process and what conclusions you have reached, for example, about the proposition for Scotland to maintain membership of the single market alongside membership of the UK customs union?
Well, I think we touched on this the last time I was here. I mean, I haven't seen evidence that suggests that there is the possibility of membership of the single market without many of the other, without effectively EU membership and the various things with that. But I think I've set out in detail in the letter that a work stream has been established in relation to access to the single market, so where all the alternatives are being examined, and the detail involving lawyers and others in relation to those sort of proposals are actually being gone through.
And what will be the outcome of that process? In other words, will the UK government publish its conclusions on that process, and if so, at what stage in relation to the invoking of Article 50?
My view is that the invoking of Article 50, in a sense, is not, is not a red line in the process, and it will be possible that discussions could continue after Article 50 was invoked. But clearly, yourselves, the Scottish Government, are entitled to a response. So the UK Government will respond formally to the proposals contained within the document, just as we've done so far in terms of acknowledging those areas in which we're in agreement.
And while you're saying that you don't see the Article 50 invocation as a cut-off point for that response, can you indicate the timescale in which you hope to respond to not just the Scottish Government, or the Welsh Government has also made proposals which have some things in common with those and clearly are important too. And I wonder what time scale you have in mind for responding to those and completing the work that's underway at the moment.
As soon as is practical. I know that's not that's not definitive, but I think it's to everyone's benefit that we have we can reach as early a conclusion as we can.
One of the things I think that's been clear in this in the last few weeks is that the Prime Minister of the UK Government have come to conclusions around the issue of UK membership of the single market. The issues that we raised with Mr. Hands were around what alternatives to membership would provide access. And I wonder, given what you said about the importance of those issues from a Scottish perspective, what consideration or what role the Scotland Office has in relation to questions of access to the single market. And again, whether there are particular aspects of that are of importance to you and to the interest you represent here.
Well, clearly, there are many areas within the Scottish economy for which access is vitally important, and I I absolutely acknowledge that. I think that we've said before that the work that's ongoing, and this is work where there is, again, agreement with the Scottish Government, at least in relation to the data, because everyone clear, we have to have a common set of data and on which to proceed. So one of the issues on which I thought Mr. Russell may disagree, but there was actually a pretty substantive discussion at the last meeting of the JMCEN, was in relation to financial services and in relation to the significant importance of financial services. And one of the issues I have, and it's a matter in which as anything that can be done by the Scottish Government and members of this Parliament would be helpful, because there's far too glib a use of the phrase City of London when people are talking about financial services. As if that, it's the City of London, and of course that brings with it, certain connotations which are sometimes negative. Whereas actually, financial services are right across the UK. It was a point that at that meeting the Northern Ireland Executive made, the Welsh Government made, the importance in the respective parts of the UK of financial services. So there was a very, very significant discussion in relation to financial services and relation to, for example, the current passporting regime, but whether, if it didn't continue, whether something equivalent could continue. So there was a dialogue involving the Chancellor. So financial services clearly an example of one of the areas where the importance in Scotland, the importance here in Edinburgh in particular, needs to be emphasised.
And migration, I think, is the other thing you mentioned in your earlier answers as an issue where there are clearly common interests for Scotland and for the rest of the UK. Do you accept, though, that that it's possible to envisage a situation where there is a common UK immigration system, but differentiation within that, not just necessarily for Scotland, but potentially for London, as we've heard when we met the Greater London Assembly Committee, and indeed for other parts of the UK?
I think, firstly, I would say that obviously I've received the committee's paper on migration, and I want to respond formally. That's again, a serious and substantial piece of work. The Scottish Affairs Select Committee, in fact, had done some work in that regard. What the position is, and I think it's important that it's clear, is that what's happening will be to bring back control of immigration in relation to people coming from the EU to the United Kingdom to the UK. It doesn't mean that immigration is being switched off. There will still clearly need to be significant numbers of people coming to do a whole range of things, from specialist work through to the seasonal work that we talked about. And that's why the government's announced that there will be an immigration bill which will essentially parallel or be dovetailed with the Great Repeal Bill. And that will be an opportunity for debate and discussion around the issue of immigration, specifically in relation to those EU citizens who, for whom the current arrangements will no longer apply.
Okay. Well, finally, very quickly, on principle then, that bill, when that bill comes before Parliament, are you on principle opposed to or open to the possibility of differential arrangements around European Union migration, either on a sectoral or on a geographical basis?
I think it's clear that there will require to be sectoral consideration. There will require to be sectoral considerations. Will require to have some form of equivalent to the previous seasonal workers scheme. I think that we need to address issues around depopulation and the provision of services in those areas. I'm not. Which I've said previously, and it, of course, was not part of the work of the Smith Commission. I mean, I'm not minded to a view that immigration should be devolved, that the Scottish Government clearly have made that case. But in relation to going forward, we want to have an immigration system that allows for those jobs which are necessary within our economy to be filled.
Okay, Jackson Carlow.
No, good morning, Secretary of State. You've actually covered a lot of ground in the answers you've given. I'd just like to come back to the letter that you have supplied to the committee this morning and to thank you for it, especially in terms of the detail that you have been able to share with us with regard to the various meetings that have taken place. I have to say that Mr. Russell has been rather economical in the details, since most of this is certainly news to the committee. And I personally certainly feel misled by the Minister as to the extent of the discussions that have taken place. Indeed, it's only through you that we understand he's meeting with Mr. Davis this morning. You make reference in here to the work streams that are underway, and I think in response to Lewis MacDonald, you confirmed that at some point there will be an official response to the Scottish Government's white paper. And I'm wondering, in the interests of public scrutiny, will the kind of work streams of the various groups that have been taking these proposals through be available for public scrutiny as part of any published response that ultimately the UK government is able to publish?
Those are clearly joint activities between the UK and the Scottish Government. So, I mean, if you were expressing a view that they should, then I will go back and raise that point, because I couldn't unilaterally say yes in relation to that, obviously.
And the nature of the discussions that are taking place, I mean, you characterise it as constructive and positive. The officials are actually making progress in your regard and actually teasing out the particular issues on which conclusions need to be reached.
I think that the officials have made, you know, significant they have made significant progress in terms of taking the issues forward. Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Secretary
Good
of State.
Morning.
My questions are around repatriation of powers from the European Union. Yeah. In line with the Scotland Act, any powers coming back from the UK to the UK from Brussels should automatically come to Holyrood. The Leave campaign promised that would happen, and only a few months ago, you categorically stated that whatever the circumstances, no powers will be re-reserved to Westminster. Can you guarantee that there is not going to be any reappropriation of powers that are specifically devolved to Holyrood under the Scotland Act?
There will be no taking back of any powers currently exercised here in the Scottish Parliament. Indeed, the Welsh Assembly or the Northern Ireland Executive were absolutely clear in relation to that. What I do think needs to be done, and the first, a significant step will be is happening at that tomorrow, for example, in relation to agriculture, when Fergus Ewing is meeting with Andrea Leadsom and the representatives of the Welsh Assembly Government and the Northern Ireland Executive and my colleague Andrew Dunlop and the Secretary of State for Wales to begin discussing how agricultural arrangements might come back to the UK and its constituent parts.
So, I mean, I guess just to clarify that, you know, currently agriculture is devolved. So are you suggesting that you're going to look at repatriation of agriculture powers under the UK government?
I'm not looking to take any powers that are currently exercised by the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government, away. What we're looking to do is to ensure that we can agree an arrangement across the United Kingdom as to how agriculture will operate in a post-EU world. And that will mean that there will inevitably have to be agreement between the respective governments within the UK in terms of ensuring that we have, for example, common approaches to issues like animal health, a number of areas where there are common interests. And we need to find out how the best way to achieve that is in relation to potentially what are sometimes referred to as framework agreements, which might be four governments coming together in terms of reaching an agreement. So that's the position that we are in terms of the process. I mean, so far, there are several hundred powers which have been identified as coming back and specific responsibilities. And the way I want to proceed is in an orderly fashion where we look at we look at the consequences and the implications in relation to each area. I think that there essentially are three ways in which this matter will be taken forward. One, there are areas which will come directly to Scottish Parliament. Two, there are areas which will go directly to Westminster, none of which in that respect are matters which are currently exercised by the Scottish Parliament. And then third, there'll be areas where there'll be shared, some form of shared responsibility.
Okay. I mean, with regards to the several hundred powers, are you able to share with us the list of several hundred powers that have been identified? And just a final question was that Prime Minister in January said that part of the working carefully to ensure that powers are repatriated, it means that the right powers are returned to Westminster and the right powers are passed to devolved administrations to Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. Could you, I mean, tell us what would be the right powers and what would be the wrong powers?
I think we're at the start of that process. I come from a very devolutionist approach, and Mr. Davis has confirmed, you know, that is his approach in relation to such matters. But they are, you know, there are areas. One area I'll give as an example is, you know, in terms of water standards. Areas around water standards are hugely complicated, and there's a number of interlocking measures that fit together to do that. In fact, the whole batch of environmental responsibilities are very, very complex. So it needs to be worked through. But I'm not coming from it, and the UK government's not coming from an approach to somehow sort of, you know, make sure to take away powers from the Scottish Parliament that would naturally flow to it. But it is to ensure that there is an orderly change.
Okay.
Richard Lockhead, did you have a supplementary?
It was just to pick up on the Secretary of State's point about framework agreements. Framework agreements, of course, are completely different to powers. And I think the committee is looking for an assurance that there'll be no stopping of powers coming back to Scotland, which is a kind of repatriation to Westminster. So can you give an assurance to the committee there'll be no stopping of powers coming back to Scotland in devolved areas? One example would be fish quota. 100% of powers over fish quota in the Scottish territorial seas will come back to the Scottish Parliament.
What I can give an undertaking is that there is no intention to prevent powers coming back to the Scottish Parliament. In fact, we are committed to a devolutionist approach. But I'm not going to get into specific commitments, because the other part of this process, which I think you given the roles that you've previously talked about, is that there does have to also be a degree of engagement with stakeholders and those who have an interest in terms of how they see this approach. And that's what I'm also committed to do. But I'm clear that we want to adopt a devolutionist approach, that should be a presumption that powers do come to the Scottish Parliament.
I have a quick supplementary from Lewis MacDonald.
Thanks very much. Angela Leadsom's on record in the last few days as talking about Brexit being an opportunity for a whole new set of arrangements suitable to the interests of British agriculture. And clearly the question about whether there will continue to be agricultural subsidy is in the way that there is at the moment is one that's been thoroughly examined in this committee. Can you envisage a situation where a decision about the future of agricultural subsidies in Scotland and a decision about the future of agricultural subsidies in England would be different? And if so, how would that be managed in terms of the UK constitution?
I think that it's, firstly, I can't envisage a circumstance in which there isn't continued support for agriculture. I think that is very important. But it is it is going to be an important part of the dialogue as to how, post the common agricultural policy, that support is delivered. And, it's a serious debate. I've encouraged NFUS, for example, to engage in that debate. I've, along again, I'm sure, with Mr. Lockhead and Mr. Scott, many others, spent a long time hearing from people of various concerns about the common agricultural policy. This is an opportunity to do something different, but people need to come forward with views and thoughts in relation to how that should be taken forward. We know, and I fully acknowledge, there's some very, very distinct agricultural needs in Scotland, particularly in relation to less favoured areas, that are very, very distinct and important part of the Scottish agricultural scene. So we need to have, that full debate, discussion, participation in terms of coming forward with views.
Thank you. Tavi Scott.
Convener, and my apologies for being late. I was at the Education Committee. I haven't yet mastered the ability to be in two places at once, even in this place. Can I just carry on with that point you have been making, Secretary of State, on stakeholders, and in particular in relation to fisheries? For 17 years, you and I have both, and to say nothing of Richard Lockhead and Lewis MacDonald, have heard nothing but absolute criticism of the common fisheries policy. And yet the European Parliament's Committee on Fisheries said earlier this month, and I quote, granting access to the EU domestic market to the UK post-Brexit should be conditional on Britain continuing to respect the rights and obligations of the CFP. Did you notice that report, and have you discussed that with Mr. Russell and other Scottish government colleagues?
I did notice that report. I'm aware as well that UK MEPs didn't participate in that
indeed.
Report. And indeed,
no,
all the committee, as I understand it, all the committees of the European Parliament have been tasked with setting out their issues and priorities as the UK proceeds to leave the EU. I think it's not surprising that those member states would express that view. But our position going into the negotiations, and I mean to make absolutely clear, since it is occasionally referenced in the media, we have no intention of. There's absolutely no situation whereby fishing will be a bargaining chip in these negotiations. It's a very important industry here in Scotland. And indeed, I very much welcome the positive approach of the industry, and certainly the Fishermen's Federation document Sea of Opportunity is a very outward-looking approach. But we shouldn't, I certainly don't wish to display any complacency in relation to the tough nature of negotiations that may lie ahead.
No, presumably it's a statement of fact that Spain would like to keep the common fisheries policy and therefore the access to UK waters. Could I ask that, what discussions there have been with Mr. Ewing as the Scottish Fisheries Minister and your ministerial colleagues in relation to that matter and therefore in this case the coordination of a negotiating position once that is established, and how will that continue once Article 50 has been formally triggered?
There are discussions tomorrow which will involve Ms. Leadsom. I think that it will be extremely important, and I certainly give a commitment at that in terms of engagement going forward. Mr. Russell, in his very able way, has represented all interests as we have moved forward through this process. But I envisage, as we go forward now into the next stage, portfolio holders within the Scottish Government will play a greater role in the nature of the discussions around negotiations.
Thank you. I know Mr. Russell has fishermen as well, he reminds me, which is quite important. Finally, can I just ask, I'm not aware that the Scottish Government have yet worked out how they're going to transpose fishing regulation into Scots law. Some fishing lawyers think it can take literally years and years and years. Has the UK government done any work on that, which they could genuinely share with the Scottish government? Because this is a fraught area of potential regulation.
It isn't just going to be fishing. I mean, there are going to be other areas.
Sure.
I mean, I've had a very serious conversation with Mr. Russell about these legal issues, because I think that's one thing. We can do all the necessary politicking, but I'm absolutely clear that the Scottish Government do recognise the importance of not ending up in a legal vacuum and creating unnecessary legal difficulties. So there's quite a lot of work going on in relation to scoping out the scale of that, scoping out, and I myself also met with the presiding officer here in the Parliament, scoping out the number of regulations that would need to be changed, the number of hours the Parliament might need to sit to change those regulations. I mean, obviously, both governments ultimately would probably prefer to proceed on the basis of including a sort of line that ministers will change legislation as required. I very much doubt that would pass through this Parliament, certainly wouldn't pass through the Commons or Lords. So we have to find a way of doing it, and there's some. I know the Scottish Government are contemplating whether we can proceed by they would want to proceed by some primary legislation here in the Scottish Parliament, or whether we would do it on a legislative consent basis or as part of a wider package. We're very, very conscious of those wider legal issues.
Thank you.
Very conscious.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Mundell.
Good morning, Alison.
With regard to post-2020 funding for agriculture and fisheries, are you personally committed to opposing a Barnett-style formula funding determination, which would see Scotland lose out compared to our current arrangements?
I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that Scotland doesn't lose out. What I think we want to now look at and develop is actually what the structure of the support and the policy will be going forward. And we're at the early stage of determining that. But for the reasons that I set out and the very, very distinct needs that Scottish agriculture has, I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that Scotland doesn't lose out. But there are a number, there are a number of options, that can go forward in relation to how the replacement of common agricultural policy would go forward. I think it's important those discussions take place as that process begins tomorrow. It's also important to be in dialogue with stakeholders such as the NFU Scotland, and Andrea Leadsom will meet the new president of NFU Scotland tomorrow, for example.
So you are quite determined that we won't lose out relative to current arrangements?
I'm absolutely determined to ensure that.
Okay. Another area you touched on earlier was sort of funding for science and so on, and a similar question with regard to the Horizon 2020 funding.
Yes.
It's not pre-allocated, and if the UK replaces that Horizon 2020 funding, would it continue to be on a competitive basis?
I think it's too early to say that. I think the issue, we're very alive to the issue, and very alive to the view, both in relation to that and other funding streams. I was in Berlin 10 days ago, and I was at the Free University there, and we had quite an extensive discussion about funding streams going forward, and obviously Erasmus as well. So we're alive to the issue, but I, I, I couldn't give a commitment at this point.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Just on that point, Mr. Mundell, you'll be aware of, and I put this to Mr. Hands as well, the recent report in the Times newspaper on the government's sectoral priorities, which said that education was a low priority. Now, given the importance of universities to the Scottish economy, why has education been designated by your government as a low priority?
It isn't a low priority, and if you look at the white paper, it's identified as one of the 12. It is identified as one of the 12 priorities. The Prime Minister
so are
has
you
been
that
very
the report in the Times
clear.
Was wrong because it's a reputable newspaper.
There are many reports in many newspapers, and I think it's best not to comment on individual reports. What we do have, is a government white paper which has been issued, which emphasises the importance that is put onto science and research.
And on Ms Johnson's point about the Common Agricultural Policy funds, we currently get 16% of CAP funds in Scotland, which supports the rural economy as well as individual farmers. Can you guarantee that we'll get the equivalent of that 16% after we leave the EU?
I think, I've set out that we don't know what the shape of that funding model will be in relation to support for agriculture. But I've given Ms Johnson a very clear commitment that I personally, and we've talked about what my roles and responsibilities should be, I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that in new arrangements that Scottish agriculture does not lose out.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Secretary of State. Just a couple of questions regarding the Sewell Convention and in Scotland. What is your assessment of Section 28.8 of the 2016 Scotland Act? I'll read the particular section. It states that, but it is recognised that the Parliament of the United Kingdom will not normally legislate with regard to devolved matters without the consent of the Scottish Parliament.
That is the position.
Okay. With that, obviously after the 2014 referendum, the Smith Commission had obviously recommended that the Sewell Convention be put on a statutory footing. And you'll be aware that Lord Wallace, when he was the Advocate General in March of 2015, Lord Wallace had stated in the Lords that, the Smith Commission recommended that we should put the Sewell Convention on a statutory footing. We have taken that faithfully and discharged it. You'll also be aware that the Devolution for the Powers Committee in its interim report of June 2015 raised concerns about the proposals, and that was a unanimous report. And you'll also be aware that in the final report of the Devolution for the Powers Committee on the 11th of March 2016, we once again raised the issue of the Sewell Convention and what was proposed in the bill, and yourself is also you're quoted certainly as speaking in the UK Parliament, stating that the permanence of the Scottish Parliament is now written in law, as is the Sewell Convention. But very recently, in the Supreme Court case, Mr. Keane, in his verbal submission to the Supreme Court, stated that the correct legal position is that Parliament is sovereign and may legislate at any time on any matter. And that is specifically set out in the devolved legislation itself, section 28.7 of the Scotland Act. And then later, Mr. Keane stated that it does not appear to me that there is any practical change as a result of section 28.8 emerging into the Scotland Act 1998. So, with those particular points that I've put to you, it's probably, I'm quite sure that anyone who's listening and anyone who's read any of the documentation that's online, they could probably come to the same conclusion as myself, that that what's in the Scotland Act 20, section 28.8 regarding the Sewell Convention is meaningless, is worthless, and it could be removed because it doesn't actually have any effect upon what actually takes place in this Parliament.
I don't accept that interpretation. I think if you look at, in detail at the Supreme Court judgment, it does set out what a convention is. That convention has been placed on a legal footing, but it is a convention. That was thoroughly debated in its passage through Parliament. I don't think that anyone who paid specific attention to that issue was in any doubt as to the legal basis in relation to that convention. And indeed, when if you care in terms of the Supreme Court to look at the pleadings which were made by the Lord Advocate on behalf of the Scottish government, he doesn't challenge the basis of a parliamentary sovereignty. I have made it absolutely clear that there is no, following the judgment, there's no intention to change the operation of the Sewell Convention as we engage fully with this Parliament. And I've said, for example, I was very clear, and indeed the Scottish Government appear to have accepted it, that the Article 50 bill did not require a legislative consent motion because it related to matters which were entirely the responsibility of the UK government, but that when we bring forward the Great Repeal Bill, which I anticipate on the basis of questions and I've answered before, will change powers and responsibilities of this Parliament, then that is a matter, subject to the drafting, of course, that would require legislative consent, and of course we would seek that.
But certainly, I'm sure you could probably understand that my position and my interpretation, but also probably no doubt many others as well, that when you have a UK government representative, Mr. Keane, stating that it doesn't appear to me that there is any practical change as a result of that particular section of the Act, then it clearly indicates that that what's in the Act doesn't actually mean anything.
Well, not in relation to the convention. It's put the convention on a statutory footing, but it is a convention. Of course, all the other range of powers and responsibilities that were included in that Act are very significant. I understand yesterday that here in the Scottish Parliament, this Parliament set the rates and bans for income tax for earned income in Scotland. I regard that as very significant. That could not have happened other than the basis of the Scotland Act. But the Sewell Convention is a convention. It has been put on a statutory basis. We could have a very academic argument. There's another convention called the Ponsonby Convention. I've always, if you'll indulge me, Convener, I've always wanted Bernard to ask me about that because I understand it relates to international treaties. But they are conventions that are placed on a statutory basis. But we are absolutely, in the UK government, committed to abide by that convention. That's the approach that we're taking in all our dealings currently with the Scottish Parliament and in relation to how we approach Brexit.
No, that's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Secretary of State, since you last gave evidence to the committee, we made a visit to Brussels, and I observed that the notion that Scotland could negotiate its own membership of the EU was dismissed by a number of EU officials. What is your assessment of the likelihood of the EU27 agreeing to allow Scotland to either inherit the UK's EU membership or indeed join with a differentiated arrangement?
I set out in my opening remarks that I do not believe that there is any evidence at all to suggest that Scotland could either inherit the UK's position in the EU or could remain in the EU as the UK left. Of course, if the constitutional arrangements in Scotland were to change, then Scotland would have to apply to become a member of the EU. If we look at newspaper reports, there are numerous conflicting newspaper reports, indeed, as to what that process would involve. But I think that's quite clear. At the end of this Brexit process, Scotland will be out with the EU along with the rest of the United Kingdom.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. As someone who accompanied you to that, Rachel Hamilton, to that visit to Brussels, I was struck by the positive response that we got from many officials and politicians towards Scotland. And indeed, we did have a meeting with the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament that very recently has said that the calls for a differentiated approach for Scotland ought to be addressed. And they have actually taken quite substantive evidence. Given that that Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament, very important committee, has said that Scotland's differentiated position should be addressed, doesn't that put even more obligation on the UK government to respond to that? We now know that Europe's keen to respond.
Well, I hope that I'd set out in my earlier remarks that, you know, Scotland's place in Europe, proposals, you know, are being addressed, and they're being addressed in a serious and, I hope, constructive way. I'm not in any way offering a pretense that ultimately, you know, we may agree on everything. There's a very, very substantial body of views and outcomes that we do agree on. That's clear, and we will continue to work with the Scottish Government to reach a conclusion on which we will, you know, offer a definitive view.
So you understand why people are sceptical of that Secretary of State, because Scotland's place in Europe, the first part of it, proposed that the UK should remain in the EEA. Now, before that was even considered at the JMC, the Prime Minister made her speech at Lancaster House and completely dismissed that and said we're outside the single market. So right from the outset, you know, you talk about a respect agenda, but right from the outset, you dismissed a key aspect of that paper, a big compromise, in fact, because it's about UK membership, the EEA. That wasn't even considered. So this committee brought out a report on a differentiated immigration system for Scotland, which was unanimously signed off by this committee. You're dismissing that. So on those two areas, you say that you're listening to this place, that you respect us, but you have just dismissed Scotland's views.
I haven't done that. I don't think, of course, Scotland has two parliaments, so the views of this committee and this parliament are very important, but wider views are important too. My reading of Scotland's place in Europe was it was predicated on the basis that here's what we'd ideally like the UK to do, but we don't anticipate that they'll do it because of the various pronouncements that the Prime Minister had already made in relation to that. So the document itself doesn't in any way, on my reading of the document, it doesn't in any way anticipate that part one will be the outcome. What its substantive part is about parts two and three and how those can be achieved. I'm sorry if I didn't make it clear that I have your report. I take that report seriously. It's got detailed figures and numbers. I mean, some of those are not. If we were talking about the Times newspaper has an interesting report today about migration in it. But you know, what I will undertake to you and to the committee is that I'll respond formally. I'll do that in the way that I always do, in terms of having an open mind in relation to evidence that is provided. But I am not in any way disrespectful of the report or the work of this committee, which I particularly commend the first piece of work, which has been extremely useful and which we have used within the UK government, that you know, set out initial views from those people from whom you took evidence.
No, thank you. I'm glad you did find it useful. Obviously, those people overwhelmingly wanted to remain in the single market. Just before you go, and I do appreciate your time and that we have gone over time, you earlier mentioned, in response to Emma Harper's question, water regulations as an area of interest in terms of regulations throughout the UK. I thought that was an odd example, given that water is privatised in England and it's not in Scotland.
I was actually referencing, perhaps I should be more specific, to water that's in rivers and in the rain and coastal
right.
arrangements. But what I could do, and subject to caveated by just confirming with the officials, but I could share with you maybe a specific example of what I was was referencing. But it wasn't in relation to to drinking water as such, although of course some other water sources as well.
Right. Because in the report you refer to what Scotland thinks, there was unanimous concern from the environmental organisations that the loss of the European Court of Justice would mean that the Scotland's high quality of environmental regulations would not have an arbiter. Mm-hmm. And speaking to your colleague Greg Hands earlier, he wasn't able to say what kind of arbiter would be in place to replace the European Court of Justice, which Prime Minister says very clearly that we're mm-hmm. leaving. Do you understand those concerns of those environmental organisations
first,
in Scotland?
Firstly, I do, but I do understand those concerns, and we very much need to maintain environmental standards, and that's one of the reasons that the Great Repeal Bill and the process and the sort of legal issues that Mr. Scott referred to are so important, because we don't want, at the point we leave the EU, for that, you know, hard-fought, in many cases, environmental framework to be undermined, and that's why the Great Repeal Bill is so important. Clearly, within our own UK legal system, we'll have the Supreme Court, but in relation to any other arrangements, there will have to be an arbitration body. There are, in relation to a number of other arrangements the EU has with different organisations, but I mean, Mr. Hands is being open and forthright that it's not clear what that will be at this stage, but it's clear that there will have to be one.
Okay, we'll wait and see. And thank you very much for coming to give evidence to us today, Mr. Mundell. And can you give us perhaps some indication as to whether you're able to come back after the Article 50 letter is submitted?
I would be very pleased to do so, convener.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll have a